Before we get started, we want to make sure that you've got what you need to worship with us this morning. You'll need to print the worship bulletin. You will need to print the song lyrics. You'll probably want to print the sermon notes. And you might also want to print this week's copy of the Southview Spirit. If you don't already have those things in hand, then you can go ahead and pause the video right now, get those printed off. The other thing you want to do is make sure that you have your communion elements as well, because we will be taking communion with you later in the service. But once again, I want to thank you so much for joining us for online worship this morning. At this time, we will sing our opening hymn, which is, I Love to Tell the Story.
Thank you.
Sure. Simply beautiful. Well, friends, we've come to the time of the service when we share our joys and our concerns. We've mentioned this previously, but if you have a joy or if you have a concern that you would like for us to mention on the online worship service, we would be happy to do that. Please just email me and let me know, and we will incorporate your request or your joys into a future service. This morning, we want to continue to lift up those that we have been lifting up, those that are in hospice care, those who are in the hospital, those who are dealing with cancer that we've been praying for them about. We want to lift up those who have shared with me what we consider to be unspoken prayer concerns. We want to pray, as we always do, for unity in our nation. We want to pray that God would use us to be the peacemakers, use us to be the bridge builders. And of course, the greatest thing is that we want to pray for those that are battling the coronavirus. Those are on the front lines, our healthcare workers, our first responders, those who are in the food service industry, those who are working in the grocery stores, those who are doing deliveries. We want to lift all of those people up. Well, friends, at this time, we will go ahead and sing our prayer hymn, which is, "Are Ye Able?" Said the Master.
Thine is the kingdom
and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, friends, normally this would be the time of the service when we would receive the offering. I want to remind you, as always, that you can continue to support Southview. There should be a link just a few posts above on the Facebook page that will remind you of the various different ways that you can continue to support our church. And friends, we want to thank everyone who has been supporting us. We deeply, deeply appreciate it. And we continue to appreciate your ongoing efforts to support us through this very, very challenging time. Well, friends, at this time, we will go ahead and sing the doxology together. Well, folks, all of us at some point in our lives have found ourselves in trouble. And all of us at some point in our lives have been punished. I think that's true for literally 100% of us in this world. But it's one thing to be punished for doing something wrong. It's another thing when the person who punishes you also makes sure that you are embarrassed in the process. Probably bringing back some bad memories for some of you of a time or an occasion when you did something wrong and you got punished for it, but maybe it was a parent, maybe it was a teacher, whoever it was, they also made sure that you were embarrassed. When I was in high school, I was invited to attend this student council thing that brought together kids from a bunch of different high schools in the town that I lived in, Albuquerque, Mexico. At this conference, it was during the summer, there were probably well over 100 kids that attended this. And because it was a student council thing, there were a lot of pretty girls who were at this conference. So I was pretty happy to be there. It just so happened that the last night of the conference, they had a dance, which was really, really great. Especially when you're one of the few boys, when there's a lot of pretty girls, it was a great position that I found myself in. In fact, I was so excited about it that I thought, gosh, I really wish that my best friend was with me, because he would love this too. No, my best friend wasn't in student council, but I went ahead and I gave him a call. And I said, let's see if we can sneak into the dance tonight. You know, what could possibly be the harm of just sneaking into a dance? So that's what we did. We snuck my best friend and another friend into the dance that night. And I thought that we had gotten away with the perfect crime, but of course we had not gotten away with the perfect crime. Afterwards, they came and found me in my room and they said, did you sneak some boys into the dance tonight? And what am I going to say? I mean, obviously they knew. And so I said, yeah, I did. They said, well, you need to come down and we need to talk to you. Now, I also want to point out that this was the last night of the conference. And we were supposed to be picked up by our parents at 8 o'clock the next morning. So I only had about 9 or 10 hours left on the clock before my mom was supposed to come and pick me up anyway. But I got downstairs and my high school's activities director was there and the person who was in charge of the whole thing was there. And they were mad. They were really mad. And I was thinking to myself, for sneaking a couple of friends into a dance, that's not that big a deal. And they said, well, there was some vandalism done. I didn't do any vandalism. And he said, well, we think your friends did. And I was like, no way. And so they actually had campus police come and talk to me. I was read my rights. They had my mom come, and by this point it was 11 o'clock, 11:30 at night. My mom was not really excited about coming down to the university and sitting with me as I was interrogated by campus police. And I just told them the truth. I told them, I don't know what happened. My friend snuck in. I called them later after they got back home. And they said that, yeah, they did have quite the adventure as they were trying to get back off campus because apparently a couple of the teachers that were there for the conference were kind of chasing them. And they were trying to get away from the teachers. But I guess they thought that in the process of trying to get off campus that my friends had committed this vandalism. And they hadn't. But I got interrogated for it. And finally, when campus police were done interrogating me, they said, well, all right, you know, it doesn't sound like he's tripping over his story. He's not confused or he's not lying. And so they said, all right, well, O'Brien, you gotta go. And so rather than waiting until the next morning and having my mom come and pick me up like they were with all the other kids, they went ahead and kicked me out right then and there at 1 a.m. in the morning. So I had to go back upstairs. I had to wake up my roommates as I was packing up all my stuff. And of course, then the next morning, I was told later that was quite the fun conversation that my friends had about, Gary got kicked out last night. What happened? He snuck some people into the dance. And if you can't tell, it's now been 30 plus years since that happened. I still think it was kind of ridiculous. I mean, I just snuck a couple of friends into a dance. But man, they made a federal case out of it, and they kicked me out at 1 o'clock in the morning. My mom was gonna come back 7-8 hours later to pick me up anyway. But I think they wanted to make an example of me. I think they wanted to embarrass me.
I have a question for you.
Yes?
Did you find out who did it?
No, we have no idea who committed the vandalism. They don't even know that the vandalism was something that happened that night. It was something that could have happened at any time during that summer, but they wanted to punish me and punish my friends for it. So, who knows? Who knows? But the reason I bring that up is because in the passage we're going to look at today, our friend Jeremiah is going to be punished, but not only is he going to be punished, but they're also going to embarrass him. They're going to make an example of him as well. For those who were with us last week, you know that we started a new sermon series based on the Old Testament prophet, Jeremiah. We started a new sermon series based on the life and the writings of Jeremiah. And the title of the sermon series is The Prophet of Gloom and Doom. Because that was Jeremiah's and that is Jeremiah's reputation. He is sometimes referred to as the weeping prophet. Jeremiah served from the 600s BC to the 500s BC. And in the passage we looked at last week, we saw where Jeremiah was called by God. And Jeremiah said, I'm too young. I don't think I'm the right guy. And God said, no, you are the right guy. And so today, we're going to jump forward from where we were last week in Jeremiah chapter 1. We're jumping ahead to Jeremiah chapter 11. And we're going to jump ahead to chapter 20. And we're going to see where Jeremiah starts running into some opposition, starts running into some trouble. So, let's go ahead and take a look at our scriptures. These are abridged versions of Jeremiah 11 and Jeremiah 20. This is the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. From the time I brought your ancestors up from Egypt until today, I warned them again and again, saying, obey me. But they did not listen or pay attention. They have returned the sins of their ancestors. They have followed other gods. Therefore, this is what the Lord says. I will bring on them a disaster. The towns of Judah and the people of Jerusalem will go and cry out to the gods to whom they burn incense, but they will not help them at all when disaster strikes. The Lord revealed their plot to me. He showed me what they were doing. I have been like a gentle lamb led to the slaughter. I did not realize they had plotted against me. Therefore, this is what the Lord says about the people who were threatening to kill me, saying, do not prophesy in the name of the Lord, or you will die by our hands. I will punish them. Not even a remnant will be left, because I will bring disaster on them. Now, let's skip ahead about 9 chapters to Jeremiah chapter 20, and we're going to see that basically the same thing is going on 9 chapters later. When the priest Pashur, the official in charge of the temple, heard Jeremiah prophesying, he had Jeremiah beaten and put in stocks. The next day when Pashur released Jeremiah from the stocks, Jeremiah said, this is what the Lord says, I will give all Judah into the hands of Babylon, who will carry them away. I will deliver all the wealth of this city into the hands of Babylon. And you, Pashur, and all who live in your house will go into exile to Babylon. There you will die and be buried. Jeremiah said, I'm ridiculed all day long. Everyone mocks me. But the word of the Lord has brought me insult and reproach all day long. But if I say, I will not mention this word or speak any more in his name, his word in my heart is like a fire shut up in my bones. I am weary of holding it in. Indeed, I cannot. The Lord is with me like a mighty warrior, so my persecutors will not prevail. So, this is our friend Jeremiah saying, I'm going to keep preaching the truth no matter what. So first of all, let's go ahead and talk through these 2 chapters, and let me just put a little bit finer point on a few aspects of both of these chapters, and then after that, we'll talk about the lessons that these chapters have for us. So first of all, it tells us that Jeremiah in chapter 11 is saying that his people, the Hebrew people, have returned to the sins of their ancestors. They have followed other gods. And we know this to be true from the Old Testament. We know that the Hebrew people, again and again, as much as they were reminded that they were supposed to worship the Lord and worship the Lord alone, time and time again, we find them going to worship Baal, and we find them going to worship Asherah. They've been warned about this for centuries now, and yet they keep falling into these same patterns. And God says, look, I'm at the end of my rope with you guys, and I'm not going to help you when disaster strikes. So Jeremiah is proclaiming this, and in the meantime, he is being persecuted by the Hebrew people. The same people that he's trying to help, he's trying to say, look, you got to cut this out. They're getting mad, and they're persecuting him in return. Jeremiah says, I'm getting in so much trouble here, I feel like I am a lamb led to the slaughter. If you ever wondered where that phrase came from, this is where that phrase came from, a lamb to the slaughter. And Jeremiah says, they keep telling me not to prophesy, or else they're going to kill me. And what I'm saying is what God is telling me, which is if they follow through with that, God is going to bring disaster on them. So that's Jeremiah 11. And now let's jump ahead to Jeremiah chapter 20. We're introduced to the priest who is in charge at this point in Hebrew history, and the priest's name is Pashur. And we've talked before about the fact that many times when you find a name in the Bible, the meaning of that name is significant. In this case, the name Pashur means one who splits. And we can certainly see where, in a sense, that is a meaningful name in the case of Pashur, because pretty soon the southern kingdom is going to be split off as they're taken off into exile. So Pashur has Jeremiah arrested, not only arrested, but has Jeremiah beaten and put into stocks. And what's the purpose of putting someone in stocks? Well, to make an example of them, to embarrass them, and to show everybody else, if you do what this guy did, then we're going to do the same thing to you. And so then when Pashur comes back and releases Jeremiah, what does Jeremiah do? He continues to proclaim the truth. He continues to tell Pashur exactly what's going to happen. And he says, you, Pasha, I'm talking to you, buddy. He says, you need to know that when the Babylonians come and take us into captivity, they're going to take you, they're going to take your entire family, and you will never set foot in Israel again. You and your family is going to die in exile in Babylon. And sadly, that is exactly what happened. And then Jeremiah, at the very end of chapter 20, kind of gives this soliloquy. And Jeremiah says, look, I know that I keep getting in trouble over and over again for proclaiming the truth. He says, sometimes I feel like I should just hold it in. He says, but I can't. I have to preach the truth. I have to proclaim the truth. And I think for many of us, sometimes we have experienced that ourselves, where we feel like there's this truth that we have to proclaim. So, what are the lessons that we should take away from these two chapters as we see Jeremiah persecuted? Well, I think the first lesson that we should take away from the passage is this. We can't afford to keep repeating the mistakes of those who came before us, because repeated mistakes will ultimately have consequences. We can't afford to keep repeating the mistakes of those who came before us, because repeated mistakes will ultimately have consequences. Look, all of us make mistakes. And what we're supposed to do is we're supposed to learn from those mistakes. We're supposed to say, all right, I'm not going to do that again. You look at the example of the Hebrew people after they came back from captivity in Egypt, and God said, worship me and worship me alone. And they couldn't do it. They kept going astray, and they kept worshiping Baal, and they kept worshiping Asherah, and they've been warned and warned. And now Jeremiah comes along and says, God is at the end of his rope. This is your last chance. And yet even then, they couldn't learn from their mistakes. And sure enough, we know that at the end of Jeremiah's ministry, that's exactly what happened. In 586 BC, the Hebrews were carried off into captivity in Babylon. So I think something that we need to ask ourselves is, what are the mistakes that we are repeating? Because I think that all of us as individuals would probably say, well, yeah, there are certain mistakes that I'm continuing to commit in my life, and I need to stop. And so as individuals, we need to ask ourselves that question. But I also think as a society, we need to ask ourselves that question as well. What mistakes are we continuing to repeat as a society? Because this was the Hebrew society that paid the price. It wasn't just the individuals. It was the entire Hebrew nation that was carried off into captivity in Babylon. Their entire nation paid the price. And so what mistakes are our nation repeating that we're going to pay the price? And our children and our grandchildren are going to pay the price. I think that's something for us to contemplate. That's the first lesson we should take away from this passage. The second lesson is this: not everyone will appreciate it when we speak the truth. Not everyone will appreciate it when we speak the truth. In this passage, in these passages, we see where Jeremiah is persecuted, where he's opposed, because he kept proclaiming the truth. And I think that most of us have probably experienced that as well. I remember a time, and I'm not going to say when it was or what pastor it was, but there was a time, I've served about 10 or 12 senior pastors over the course of my entire 28 years as being a pastor. And there was one time where a pastor said, hey, we're thinking about this. What do you guys think? He brought it to us as a church staff. And nobody said anything. So I said, well, I think that's a bad idea. And I'm not going to get into specifics, but I said, I think that's a bad idea. And I gave a scriptural reason why I thought that was a bad idea. And it was at that point that this senior pastor kind of showed his hand, because he kind of got mad at me. And he kind of started arguing with me and just kind of dismissing my scriptural reason why I thought it was a bad idea. So what was I supposed to do? I just said, well, this is what the scripture says. And ultimately, that plan was not implemented. I don't think necessarily because of what I said, but I have a feeling that as that idea was shared with other people, I'm guessing that that idea got some pushback from other places as well. But it just goes to show, it just goes to reinforce that not everyone appreciates it when we speak the truth. But the final lesson, but we can't stop speaking the truth either. But we can't stop speaking the truth either. Jeremiah had been warned, he had been opposed, he had been prosecuted, he had been threatened, and he never shut up. He just kept proclaiming the truth. And Jeremiah shares what I think is incredibly inspiring words in Jeremiah 20, verse 9. Jeremiah says, if I say, I will not mention God's word or speak anymore in God's name, then God's word is like a fire in my heart, a fire shut up in my bones. I can't hold it in anymore. And friends, I think for us, we need to have that same, similar conviction. We need to be able to say, look, it may not be popular, it may lead to some trouble for me, but I'm going to keep proclaiming the truth, no matter what. We need to follow the example of Jeremiah and emulate the courage that he demonstrates in this passage. Well, friends, that's where we'll leave off today. Next week, we'll come back and we'll see what happens next with our friend Jeremiah. In this passage, we see where Jeremiah was persecuted for proclaiming the truth. And, of course, we know that someone else who proclaimed the truth in the New Testament was Jesus. And even when Jesus was opposed, and even when Jesus was persecuted, he continued to proclaim the truth to the very end. But as a result, Jesus was crucified. And friends, every week when we gather around the Lord's table, we honor the fact that Jesus made that sacrifice on our behalf. And so friends, at this time, as we prepare to gather around the Lord's table, we're going to sing our communion hymn together. Our communion hymn is Let Us Break Bread Together.
the bread and the cup. We give you thanks, O Lord, for you are good, and your steadfast love endures forever. As did the disciples of old, we felt lost from your love, and our fears drove us into hiding. Now we can cast aside the fears that once weighed us down. For our Christ is risen, and the death we fear most has lost its sting. In this bread and cup we remember the broken body of Jesus, and the fact that you loved us unto death. Yet also in this bread and cup we find that our food of our souls to nourish and strengthen us in the living Christ. As we eat this bread and drink this cup, we come out of our hiding to tell the whole world that our Christ is alive. Amen.
Amen. Well, friends, those of you that are worshiping with us online, I would encourage you to take this time now to partake of communion. Speaking the truth.